They'll come back for the summer and have a formal memorial service for her. We probably, and I'm sure we will, we're going to do, though, a small or a interment for her in the columbarium in January, some Sunday, just as an opportunity to place her remains in the columbarium. So we'll let you know on that. Any other prayer concerns that we need? Continue to keep Raleigh in our prayers and his family and Edie. Has he kind of the same as he was last week? Okay, good. Anything else? Please pray for everybody who will be traveling. After service, this is just a little note, we are not going to, and I will announce it again, but we're not going to have Christmas Eve service live. It will be recorded, and it will be on Facebook, YouTube, and on our webpage Christmas Eve night. I'm planning about 6 o'clock. Of course, with it being recorded, you can watch it multiple times, or you don't have to watch it 6, you can wait till 8 or 9, whatever. But after service today, if you would please, other than the choir and some readers, kind of exit, because we're going to be recording the choir numbers and the service, so it'll be kind of a full day. Anything else that we need for the good of the community? Please pray for everybody as we travel. I'll just announce that later. Let's go. The Christmas Eve service will be recorded on Facebook and YouTube, and will be on our website at 6. Youth activities today, they have a Zoom. All of their meetings now will be Zoom. They're not going to have a lock-in. Where did Carrie go? There he is. You're not having a lock-in this year. You're having a Zoom-in? No. but this week, it's a Christmas movie. Then next week, New Year's goals and the role in our Christian faith. Choir practice, wildfire relief. We're not relieving wildlife. But anyway, last opportunity if you want to give to that, and then the session will pass out those funds to those in need from our fires this summer. My adult online class, the New Testament You Never Knew, we're on session 5, and our next class will be on January 6th, so watch for it. If you want to join us, you're more than welcome to. They are continuation, but if you miss the first ones, you don't miss anything. By picking up, and this one will be really good. Dr. N.T. Wright is the foremost scholar of Paul in the world today. He's the one that's doing the video along with a companion of his, Michael Bird, I think that's right. And Michael is a lecturer in New Testament in Australia. So they're very, very fine education, and this one on Paul is going to be really good. Welcome to guests. If you're a guest, we're welcome to have you here today and worshiping with us, and glad you're braving the time and staying nicely social distance. We really appreciate that. There is hope for your future, says the Lord, from Jeremiah 31. Isn't that great? There is hope for our future. Listen, I'm standing at the door knocking. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to you and eat with you, and you with me. And that's the promise of Jesus. He's standing there waiting for us to come. Oh, I forgot one last thing before we go to the silence. If you would like, we'd like some of the poinsettias to stay. So, but if you would like to pick up your poinsettia after the service, please do that. Please see Pat. We will record, so having a lot of these will just add to the quality of our our recording for the Christmas Eve service. Let's go to God and open our hearts, prepare ourselves to hear God's word and to worship Him.
Thank you, Gil and Joan. That was really nice. And I also want to say that the poinsettias look really nice. Thank you, Pat, for arranging these. Please join me in the call to worship. Let us praise our Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah. Jesus is coming.
At Christmas, Jesus came as a baby.
Hallelujah. Jesus is coming.
He came to be like us because He loves us.
Hallelujah. Jesus is coming.
Today we relight the first three candles of the Advent wreath, the candles of hope, peace, and joy.
We light the fourth candle of Advent. This is the candle of love.
Jesus demonstrated self-giving love in His ministry as the Good Shepherd. Advent is a time for kindness, thinking of others, and sharing with others. It is a time to love as God loved us by giving us His most precious gift. As God is love, let us be love also. From the Gospel of John, we hear, I give you a new commandment that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Let us pray.
Teach us to love, O Lord.
May we always remember to put you first as we follow Christ's footsteps, that we may know your love and show it in our lives. As we prepare for our celebration of Jesus' birth, also fill our hearts with love for the world, that all may know your love and the one whom you have sent, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
Please stand if you are able. Our first hymn is O Come, Emmanuel, and then the second hymn is Joy to the World. Prepare the way of the Lord. Let us make our confession to God.
Lord, we confess our willingness to be loved, but also our reluctance to love. We confess our readiness to accept your forgiving love, but also your refusal to forgive. We confess our eagerness to grasp your offer of redeeming love, but also our resistance to follow you without question. In this Advent time, forgive us our failure to respond as we should. Come to us anew, and by your grace, assist us to receive you with joy, as the shepherds, with gratitude as Simeon, with obedience as Mary, with love as you have loved us. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
People of God, Jesus Christ our Lord, whose coming we announce in this season, is our righteousness. In Christ we are made right with God.
Glory be to God.
As God has given us peace through Christ, so let us pass the peace of Christ to each other. The peace of Christ be with you all.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Cora.
John, give him a clap.
That's a social distancing thing.
Amen to that. Will you pray with me now? O gracious God and most merciful Father, you have given us the rich and precious jewel of your holy word. Assist us with your spirit that it may be written in our hearts to our everlasting comfort, to reform us, to renew us according to your own image, to build us up into the perfect building of Christ, and to increase us all in heavenly virtues. Grant this, O heavenly Father, for the name, same Jesus, name of Jesus' sake. Amen. Listen now for the word of God from Psalm 89. I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. With my mouth I will make known your faithfulness to all generations. For I said, steadfast love will be built up forever. In the heavens you will establish your faithfulness. You have said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant. I will establish your offspring forever and build your throne for all generations. Of old, you spoke in a vision to your godly one and said, I have granted help to one who is mighty. I have exalted one chosen from the people. I have found David, my servant, with my holy oil. I have anointed him so that my hand shall be established with him. My arm shall also strengthen him. The enemy shall not outwit him. The wicked shall not humble him. I will crush his foes before him and strike down those who hate him. My faithfulness and my steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted. I will set his hand on the sea and his right hand on the rivers. He shall cry to me, you are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. Time now for the children's message. Do we have any children today? For
good morning. Today in one of our gospel lessons, we're hearing the story of this man named Nicodemus. Now, Nicodemus was a Pharisee, and that means he was a very important individual in the Israeli world at the time. He was a church leader. And not just a church leader, but a pretty high official in the church, in the synagogues. And the thing is, he went to talk to this Jesus he heard so much about. Now, he came to Jesus at night. And the reason why he did that was because, once again, he was a Pharisee. And if people found out, the other Pharisees found out that he would come and see Jesus, who to the Pharisees was like a rabble-rouser, starting trouble and changing traditions, he could be exiled, kicked out, and his family out on the streets. So he comes to Jesus because he's very interested in seeing what he's about. So again, we're reading from the Spark Story Bible. I'll have some pictures. I don't know if Les, you could pick it up from back there or not. The light of the world. Now, in the middle of the night, a man named Nicodemus came to see Jesus. It was a strange time to visit someone, but Nicodemus had many questions about God, and he wanted to wait. There was a lot of talk about Jesus. Many people didn't believe Jesus, and Nicodemus wasn't sure what he thought about it all. He also wasn't sure he wanted anyone to see him. He knew that Jesus was talking about God in a whole new way, and some people, like his fellow Pharisees, did not like it one bit. So that night, Jesus and Nicodemus talked for quite a while. They argued and wondered together about many things, and then Jesus laid this on them. This is what Jesus said. Really, Nicodemus, all you need to know is this, that God loves you. In fact, God loves everyone. And it's important that you know this and tell everyone you meet. Okay, I'm going to show a picture. You guys, close here. Yeah, the caterpillar, man, think about all the things he's seen and known. He's done every page of the scripture, this Bible. Jesus continued, God wants everyone to know how much they are loved. Nicodemus, God loves this world and everyone in it so much that God sent me, his son, so that everyone would learn how much they are loved. God sent me to save the world, Nicodemus. Nicodemus, I am the light of the world. I am all that is good, all that is right, and God sent me to light up this world. Unfortunately, people sometimes like darkness better than light. When we do terrible things, the light is not in us. When we are mean or hateful and horrible, the world is a dark, dark place. But when we do things that are good and right, when we love each other and help one another, God's light shines brightly in the world, and God is glad. Job. All right, let's pray. Lord, you are the light of the world. We ask you to help us be your lights in the world as we share your love with others as often as possible, especially during this Christmas season when things are really tough for so many families. Let us shine your light and your love to others. In your precious name, amen.
Let's remain seated. Well, let's stand and sing another Christmas song, Gentle Mary, Later Child.
Thank you.
myself and asked Doug to come, and he's our chairman of our pulpit nominating committee, and I'm going to ask him to give us a little update on where they are.
Thanks, Charlie. I'd like to tell everybody that the PNC is making progress. We're receiving and evaluating personnel information forms, and I would say the COVID-19 situation has altered the process procedures we use, in some ways helped us, in some ways hindered us. We're right now holding all of our meetings using Zoom, but it also, most of the prospective pastors have online sermons recorded that we can review as part of our review process. So we're currently preparing questions and evaluating those PIFs, as they're called, and continue to make progress as we progress toward discerning the person that God has selected to be our next pastor. Please continue to pray for us, and we really appreciate it. Thanks.
Thanks, Doug. Sorry, I forgot. I make notes to myself, but it doesn't mean much. I also was going to announce, and then I couldn't remember, next week, actually the next two Sundays, Bev and I will be gone. One is to celebrate Christmas. The other one is we will be with our family, so we're not going to show up on January 3rd and pass anything on. We get it Montana. Aren't you glad? Next week, the Reverend Dr. Douglas from Columbia Seminary will be here, better known to most of us as Mark. I thought I'd do that just for Carrie. Mark will be preaching for us next Sunday, and I'm excited for that. I'm sorry I'll miss it. I'll watch it online. And then the next Sunday, Carrie will be preaching on January 3rd to begin the service. And then January 10th, we will have communion, and we will install our new elders into office. Let's turn to Isaiah chapter 53. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, like sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. And they made his grave with the wicked, and with the rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. And of course, this is one of the famous suffering servants passages, and is applied to Jesus as that suffering servant and the Lamb of God. From Revelation chapter 19, then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And the one sitting on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. And from his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. From 1 Corinthians chapter 15. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man also has come the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive, but each in his own order. Christ the first fruits, then it is coming, those who belong to Christ. And from John chapter 1. John the Baptist is preaching. He's down on the River Jordan and he's baptizing and he's preaching. And then we have this. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and he said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks before me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but for this purpose I came baptizing with water, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John bore witness. "I saw the Spirit descend from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I have seen and have borne witness that this is the Son of God." All this is for Jesus. And then the next day, John was standing with two of John's disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." And then from John 3:16, very famous passage, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light, because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works should be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God." We put three chrismons up this week. We put a lamb, a butterfly, and a crown. And I've been preaching on the various symbols of the chrismon, of the Christmas tree, and the chrismons that go with them, and all of them point to certain facts about God and God's and the work of Christ in the world. This Sunday is also known as the Love Sunday. We've had hope, peace, joy, and now love as we've gone through the Advent season. And love kind of sums up these three chrismons. The first one is the Lamb. And of course, that refers to Jesus and his death. Now, we're far beyond the sacrificial system of Israel. But for many, many, many generations, there would be sacrifices of animals, lambs and bulls and turtle doves and all kinds of things, and grain offerings would be given, and the priests would do all this in offering to God to take away the sins of the people of Israel. And the lamb, of course, was tied with Passover. And when they ate the Passover lamb, they would put the blood of the lamb on the doorposts of their house, so that when the destroying angel came through, he would pass over, which is not Passover, but he would pass over or bypass the houses where the blood was, and that the Israelites would be saved. And so the meaning of the lamb was very important, and you would bring the lamb to the temple to offer your sacrifice for your sin. And in Isaiah, we are told that there is a Lamb of God. And Abraham says to Isaac, as they're going up Mount Moriah, and Abraham thinks he's going to sacrifice Isaac, which of course God doesn't want him to do, and he doesn't. But as he goes up, Isaac asks him the question, "Where's the lamb?" And Abraham says to him, "God will provide. And so we have this theme of lamb going throughout the Old Testament, and we come to the New Testament, and the Lamb of God becomes God's offering for our salvation. And Jesus is, as John proclaimed and other places, is proclaimed as the Lamb of God. And he is the one who takes away the sin, so we don't have to repeat the offering time and again. The thing with the Old Testament offerings is you were never sure. Every week you had to go back and re-offer a sacrifice because you might have sinned and you might not have cleansed yourself. And so the lamb on the tree, and it seems strange, doesn't it? Because we focus in Christmas on the baby. But the lamb on the tree reminds us that this baby has come for a purpose. In fact, the angel tells Mary that your heart will be pierced and he will be for the salvation of the world, but there will also be pain with his death. So Jesus is the Lamb of God. And in the communion, I don't know if you remember, but in the Great Communion prayer, we go through and we lift up our hearts as we lift them up unto the Lord, and then we give thanks unto all that God has done, and we sing the Holy, 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 which is the hymn we'll sing in heaven. But then in the middle of that, we say, great is the mystery. Christ has died. That reminds us of the lamb, and the lamb points us to that point. The next one is the butterfly. And the butterfly has become a symbol of the resurrection because, of course, where do butterflies come from? They come from caterpillars. And do caterpillars look like butterflies? Mm-mm. In fact, they're far different. You wouldn't even hardly believe that a caterpillar and a butterfly are the same thing. And I would guess if you see butterflies, unless you are a great bug person, you might see the butterfly but never realize or remember or be able to explain what the caterpillar looks like, because they go through that change. And so the butterfly has become a symbol of the resurrection of Jesus and also of our resurrection. So we put the symbol of the death, the lamb, on the tree, but we also put the butterfly on the tree as a reminder that Jesus rose from the dead and that his body was changed and that his mortal body that died on the cross put on immortality. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, as Christ was raised, so shall we be raised, and we shall take off our mortal bodies and put on immortals. Our bodies will be related. But as different as the butterfly to the caterpillar, so probably will our bodies be. Paul really, really, really stretches language in 1 Corinthians 15, almost to the breaking point, trying to describe something that is indescribable. But that's what this points to. The butterfly reminds us that Christ was raised from the dead. Death wasn't the end. And so shall we also be raised from the dead. And then the last one that we put on this morning is the crown. And of course, the crown reminds us that Jesus is the King of Kings. Isn't it interesting that we love the story of the three kings, or the three magi, or the three wise men who came to worship Jesus? Because they had seen his star in the east, and that was a reference to the fact that there was a new king in Israel. The star was a symbol of that, and they came to worship, but they came to worship not a baby, but they came to worship the king. Of course, that's what made Herod really mad, because you don't like anybody going around saying that they're king when you're king. And of course, if Herod could have, he would have killed Jesus right then. But Jesus in the manger, walking by the Sea of Galilee, hanging on the cross, in the tomb, outside of the tomb, raised from the dead, is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so the symbol of the crown reminds us that Jesus is our King. And that great passage out of Revelation, out of 19, when we read of the coming of the King of Kings, and that, you know, I mean, part of it is really terrible. He fights and he has swords coming out of his mouth and all of the paraphernalia of that. But the key part is that he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He rules over all. And in the creed, like in the Apostles' Creed, we confess that Christ died, that Christ was raised, and then we confess that he ascended into heaven and is coming back as King of Kings. And so we go back to the prayer around communion. And we say, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. That is the key life, key faith of Christians. That's our bedrock. It's where we stand. And when we come at Christmas time and we celebrate the birth of Jesus, we have to remember that we are celebrating more than just the baby. We are celebrating more than just good feelings. We are celebrating the gift of God. And that brings us to the final thing, love. And that great passage out of John, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, our Lord. God has not abandoned the world. He did not abandon it when he chased Adam and Eve out of the garden because they disobeyed him. He didn't abandon them after the flood. He didn't abandon them through the years. He is planning and preparing the time for Jesus to come. Because God loves this world that he created and made and put us in it. And he wants to renew his relationship and our fellowship with him. And so he sent his Son, our Lord Jesus, for that purpose. And that love is demonstrated at the cradle or the manger and the cross and the tomb and his ascension to God's right hand. And so when we wrap all this up, this forms a complete circle of God's love to us. And so when we look at the tree and we see the stars and we see the crosses and the omegas and the alphas and the IHS, all of that, and we see the lamb and the butterfly and the crown, we're reminded in rich symbolism of what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. And that's why we worship. And I pray this season, I know it's going to be different. Bev and I are planning to go to Montana to be with our daughter, but we keep telling her every time we talk to her, how are you feeling? That's the standard question, because if she doesn't feel good, we're not going. We're not going to enter into a family of, well, we're not sure how many will be there. Becky has an open house, so people come and go all the time. And it's great, but COVID has changed things. Some of you will be getting together with family. Some of you won't. You maybe will be using Zoom or FaceTime or whatever and talking together. You might be by yourself. We're really sad that in a sense we can't have our church dinner. We can't have Christmas. We've chosen not to have the Christmas Eve service life. All these changes. But our prayer, my prayer, my wife's prayer for you, is that God would bless you richly in this Christmas season. And for you to think and remember that in the midst of a very difficult time, Mary and Joseph came to Bethlehem, and there she gave birth to her firstborn son and laid him in a manger. That child was the Lamb of God. He was the one who is going to be raised again from the third day. He was the one and is the one that is the King of Kings. And that's where we worship. And it doesn't matter whether we're together or far apart. That is the key of the season. Let's pray. Gracious and almighty God, we bow before your presence and ask that you would fill us with your grace and mercy and love. Lord, give us hearts like Joseph and Mary, that when you call, we are able to say, yes, Lord, and then do what you've called us. And Lord, we thank you for the gift of Jesus, who is the Lamb of God, who is the one who is raised from the dead and through whom we will have our own resurrection, and who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we look forward to that time when he comes again. In his name do we pray. Amen. We respond with our gifts, and I'd like to, and we have done a lot. I'm really impressed with all that you do as a church. We have had good support financially, but we have also done things. We have shared with the people of need from the fire, and our mission committee have taken care of, have passed out our gifts that we normally give to our children in our elementary school. We've done stuff for the homeless. It's really a good thing. And we have been able to continue that, even though it's all been different. And so as you leave, if you want to leave an offering, there's three baskets and by the three doors, and please do that. I'll pray, and then we'll stand to sing the doxology. Gracious God, I thank you. We thank you for your gifts that you give to us. We thank you for our homes, our families. We thank you for good health. We thank you for medicine, for surgeries, for the things that you give us in that way. We thank you, Lord, that you have blessed us and continue to bless us. And we now give back a portion of those gifts. We ask that you would take them, bless them, multiply them, and use them for your kingdom and for your glory. In your Son's name do we pray. Amen.
Praise God. Seated.
As we mentioned, those that we want to be concerned about, their family, our family members. I know we all have a lot of different experiences and needs, and we want to pray during this time. I think a big part of our prayer is thankfulness that we may meet together, but also that there have been, well, there are two vaccines coming online that hopefully will help with the crisis of this COVID and the disease. And we pray for that. We pray also for all the people that have had it or who may have it. And we ask grace and mercy upon their lives. Let's go to God. Father God, this has been a different year. It would cause us concern if we thought that this caught you by surprise like it did all of us. But you knew what was going to happen, and you have been there to guide us through these times. Lord, we have had to make some adjustments. We've had not only disease, but we've had riots and fighting. We've had an election. Lord, there seems to be a lot of anger and tension and hatred amongst many people. Now, Lord, we turn to you and ask that you would guide us as individuals through this time. Help us as we live out our lives as Christians in the midst of this pandemic. Give us power by your Spirit and grace that we may be able to speak your word, that we may be your agents of love and grace and mercy, that we may encourage the faint-hearted. Lord, we know that there are many people that have not only struggled with disease or being shut in house or home or separated from loved ones, but Father, we also know that this has caused an increase in emotional and psychological issues. And Lord, people are at their wits' end, and we ask that you'd be with those around us and show us how we can encourage and support them and come alongside of them. Lord, we pray for our church. We pray for our pastor nominating committee as they go about their work of searching and going through a lot of resumes and sermons and reading all kinds of things. Lord, give them wisdom and knowledge that they may make the best decision in calling a new pastor. Help that person to come up in their thoughts and processes, and open them to receive a call from us to come and serve us in ministry here. Lord, we pray for our nation. We ask that you would guide our president and our vice president and our Congress, our president-elect, our vice president-elect, all the new officers that are coming in. Lord, we pray for our governor and our state legislature, for our county officials, for our town, our mayor, our town council. Lord, all those issues. There's so many things that are going on. Our little community right here is changing in significant ways. And so how do we as a church respond to that? And how do we reach out in love to these new people? Lord, we ask that you would guide our political people, our leaders, and give them wisdom and knowledge and understanding. Lord, we pray for those who are ill, whether it be because of the recent virus or whether it be some other health issue or a physical debility. Lord, whatever it might be, we ask that you'd be with them and would you touch and heal and strengthen them. We thank you for the gift of surgeries and medical techniques and for new vaccines. And Lord, we thank you for how fast we could put together a vaccine for this new disease. Lord, it is a gift from your hand. And we ask that it would accomplish that which we hope it would. We pray for those who care, our nurses and doctors and all in our healthcare professions. And Lord, we also remember those who respond in terms of police and fire and emergency issues. Lord, be with them and help them as well. And Lord, we think of people we meet on an everyday basis in the grocery stores and those who care for all the things that it means to live in our community. And we often don't mention them, Lord, but they are there helping, supporting, doing their jobs day after day. And we ask that you would bless them and keep them safe. Lord, we pray for ourselves. We thank you for the gifts you've given us. And we ask that you'd lead and guide us through this next week in the name and the power of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray together saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stand and sing our last hymn. Hark the herald angels sing.
Joy to all.
And as I said earlier, if you would like to take a poinsettia, please do. If you'd like to leave some for our recording for Christmas Eve, you may do that and pick them up later this afternoon. I can make sure the church stays open for that. And those of you who are helping with the service, thank you so much for staying and making this recording, and we hope it is a blessing. We've gathered together, we've heard God's word, we've sung his praises, we've shared his fellowship, but now it is your turn to go out in the world to sing God's praises, to share his love, to speak his word with each and every one you meet. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.